Welcome back, and in this lesson I want to cover IPsec fundamentals. So I want to talk about what IPsec is, why it matters, and how IPsec works at a fundamental level. Now we have a lot of theory to cover, so let's jump in and get started. At a foundational level, IPsec is a group of protocols which work together. Their aim is to set up secure networking tunnels across insecure networks. For example, connecting two secure networks, or more specifically, their routers called peers, across the public internet. Now, you might use this if you're a business with multiple sites spread around geographically and want to connect them together, or if you have infrastructure in AWS or another cloud platform and want to connect to that infrastructure. IPsec provides authentication so that only peers which are known to each other and can authenticate with each other can connect. And any traffic which is carried by the IPsec protocols is encrypted, which means to onlookers, the secure data which is being carried is ciphertext. It can't be viewed, and it can't be altered without being detected. Now, architecturally, it looks like this. We have the public internet, which is an insecure network, full of goblins looking to steal your data. Over this insecure network, we create IPsec tunnels between peers. Now, these tunnels exist as they're required. Within IPsec VPNs, there's the concept of interesting traffic. Now, interesting traffic is simply traffic which matches certain rules, and these could be based on network prefixes or match more complex traffic types. Regardless of the rules, if data matches any of those rules, it's classified as interesting traffic, and a VPN tunnel is created to carry traffic through to its destination. Now, if there's no interesting traffic, then tunnels are eventually torn down, only to be re-established when the system next detects interesting traffic. The key thing to understand is that even though those tunnels use the public internet for transit, any data within the tunnels is encrypted while transiting over that insecure network. It's protected. Now, to understand the nuance of what IPsec does, we need to refresh a few key pieces of knowledge. In my fundamental section, I talked about the different types of encryption. I mentioned symmetric and asymmetric encryption. Now, symmetric encryption is fast. It's generally really easy to perform on any modern CPU, and it has pretty low overhead. But exchanging keys is a challenge. The same keys are used to encrypt and decrypt. So how can you get the key from one entity to another securely? Do you transmit it in advance over a different medium, or do you encrypt it? If so, you run into a catch-22 situation. How do you securely transmit the encrypted key? That's why asymmetric encryption is really valuable. Now, it's slower, so we don't want to be using it all of the time, but it makes exchanging keys really simple, because different keys are used for encryption and decryption. Now, a public key is used to encrypt data, and only the corresponding private key can decrypt that data. And this means that you can safely exchange the public key while keeping the private key private. So the aim of most protocols which handle the encryption of data over the internet is to start with asymmetric encryption, use this to securely exchange symmetric keys, and then use those for ongoing encryption. Now, I mention that because it will help you understand exactly how IPsec VPN works. So let's go through it. IPsec has two main phases. If you work with VPNs, you're going to hear a lot of talk about phase one or phase two. It's going to make sense why these are needed by the end of this lesson, but understand there are two phases in setting up a given VPN connection. The first is known as Ike Phase One. Ike, or Internet Key Exchange, as the name suggests, is a protocol for how keys are exchanged, in this context, within a VPN. There are two versions, Ike version 1 and Ike version 2. Version 1 logically is older, version 2 is newer and comes with more features. Now, you don't need to know all of the detail right now, just understand that the protocol is about exchanging keys. Ike phase 1 is the slow and heavy part of the process. It's where you initially authenticate using a pre-shared key, so a password of sorts or a certificate. It's where asymmetric encryption is used to agree on, create and share symmetric keys, which are used in phase two. The end of this phase is what's known as an Ike Phase One Tunnel, or a security association known as an SA. There's lots of jargon being thrown around, and I'll be showing you how this all works visually in just a moment, but at the end of phase one, you have a Phase One Tunnel, and the heavy work of moving towards symmetric keys, which can be used for encryption, has been completed. The next step is Ike Phase 2, which is faster and much more agile, because much of the heavy lifting has been done in Phase 1. Technically, the Phase 1 keys are used as a starting point for Phase 2. Phase 2 is built on top of Phase 1 and is concerned with agreeing encryption methods and the keys used for the bulk transfer of data. The end result is an IPsec Security Association, a Phase 2 tunnel, which runs over Phase 1. Now, the reason why these different phases are split up is that it's possible for Phase 1 to be established, then a Phase 2 tunnel created, used, and then torn down when no more interesting traffic occurs, but the Phase 1 tunnel stays. It means that establishing a new Phase 2 tunnel is much faster and less work. It's an elegant and well-designed architecture. So let's look at how this all works together visually. So this is Ike Phase 1. The architecture is a simple one. Two business sites, site 1 on the left with the user Bob, and site 2 on the right with the user Julie, and in the middle, the public internet. The very first step of this process is that the routers, the two peers at either side of this architecture, need to authenticate, essentially prove their identity, which is done either using certificates or pre-shared keys. Now, it's important to understand that this isn't yet about encryption, it's about proving identity, proving that both sides agree that the other side should be part of this VPN. No keys are exchanged, it's just about identity. Once the identity has been confirmed, then we move on to the next stage of Ike Phase 1. In this stage, we use a process called Diffie-Hellman Key Exchange. Now again, I'm sorry about the jargon, but try your best to remember Diffie-Hellman, known as DH. What happens is that each side creates a Diffie-Hellman private key. This key is used to decrypt data and to sign things. You should remember this from the Encryption Fundamentals lesson. In addition, each side uses that private key and derives a corresponding public key. Now, the public key can be used to encrypt data that only that private key can decrypt. So at this point, each side has a private key as well as a corresponding public key. At this point, these public keys are exchanged, so Bob has Julie's public key and Julie has Bob's public key. Remember, these public keys are not sensitive and can only be used normally to encrypt data for decryption by the corresponding private key. The next stage of the process is actually really complicated mathematics, but at a fundamental level, each side takes its own private key and the public key of the other side and uses this to derive what's known as the Diffie-Hellman key. This key is the same at both sides, but it's been independently generated. Now again, the maths is something that's well beyond this lesson, but it's at the core of how this phase of VPN works. And at this point, it's used to exchange other key material and agreements. This part you can think of as a negotiation. The result is that each side, again, independently uses this DH key plus the exchanged key material to generate a final Phase 1 symmetrical key. This key is what's used to encrypt anything passing through the Phase 1 tunnel known as the Ike Security Association. Now, if that process seems slow and heavy, that's because it is. It's both complex and in some ways simplistically elegant at the same time, but it means that both sides have the same symmetric key without that ever having been passed between them. And the phase ends with this security association in place, and this can be used at phase two. So let's talk about that next. So in phase two, we have a few things. First, a DH key on both sides. and the same Phase 1 symmetric key also on both sides, and then finally the established Phase 1 tunnel. During this phase, both of the peers are wanting to agree how the VPN itself will be constructed. The previous phase was about allowing this, exchanging keys and allowing the peers to communicate. This phase, so Ike Phase 2, is about getting the VPN up and running, being in a position to encrypt data, so agreeing how, when, and what. So the first part of this is that the symmetric key is used to encrypt and decrypt agreements and pass more key material between the peers. The idea is that one peer is informing the other about the range of cipher suites that it supports, basically encryption methods which it can perform. The other peer, in this example the right one, will then pick the best shared one, so the best method which it also supports, and it will let the left peer know, and this becomes the agreed method of communication. Next, the DH key and the key material exchanged above is used to create a new key, a symmetrical IPsec key. This is a key which is designed for large-scale data transfer. It's an efficient and secure algorithm. And the specific one is based on the negotiation which happened above in steps 1 and 2 of this phase. So it's this key which is used for the encryption and decryption of interesting traffic across the VPN tunnel. Across each Phase 1 tunnel, you actually have a pair of security associations, one from right to left and one from left to right. And these are the security associations which are used to transfer the data between networks at either side of a VPN. Now, there are actually two different types of VPN which you need to understand: policy-based VPNs and route-based VPNs. The difference is how they match interesting traffic. Remember, this is the traffic which gets sent over a VPN. So with policy-based VPNs, there are rules created which match traffic, and based on this rule, traffic is sent over a pair of security associations, one which is used for each direction of traffic. It means that you can have different rules for different types of traffic, something which is great for more rigorous security environments. Now, the other type of VPN are route-based VPNs, and these do target matching based on prefix. For example, send traffic for 192.168.0.0/24 over this VPN. With this type of VPN, you have a single pair of security associations for each network prefix. This means all traffic types between those networks use the same pair of security associations. Now, this provides less functionality, but it is much simpler to set up. To illustrate the differences between route-based and policy-based VPNs, it's probably worth looking visually at the Phase 1 and Phase 2 architectures. Let's start with a simple route-based VPN. The Phase 1 tunnel is established using a Phase 1 tunnel key. Now, assuming that we're using a route-based VPN, then a single pair of security associations is created, one in each direction, using a single IPsec key. So this means that we have a pair of security associations, essentially a single Phase 2 tunnel running over the Phase 1 tunnel. That Phase 2 or IPsec tunnel, which is how we talk about the pair of security associations, can be dropped when there is no more interesting traffic and recreated again on top of the same Phase 1 tunnel when new traffic is detected. But the key thing to understand is that there's one Phase 1 tunnel running one Phase 2 tunnel based on routes. Running a policy-based VPN is different. We still have the same Phase 1 tunnel, but over the top of this, each policy match uses an SA pair with a unique IPsec key, and this allows us to have, for the same network, different security settings for different types of traffic. In this example, infrastructure at the top, CCTV in the middle, and financial systems at the bottom. So policy-based VPNs are more difficult to configure, but do provide much more flexibility when it comes to using different security settings for different types of traffic. Now that, at a very high level, is how VPNs function, so the security architecture of how everything interacts with everything else. Elsewhere in my course, you'll be learning how AWS use VPNs within their product set, but for now, that's everything that I wanted to cover. So go ahead and complete this video, and then when you're ready, I look forward to you joining me in the next.